Well, good morning and welcome. Our opening hymn this morning is Immortal Invisible, and as you may have noticed, the lyrics are not in your bulletin, so we get to do something fun today. If you will all pull out your hymnal from the pew in front of you and turn to number 25.
Church, all praise we would render. Oh, help us to see. 'Tis only the splendor of light hideth thee. What beautiful words we've sung this morning on this very first Sunday of November. I welcome you this morning. The grace and the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. We welcome those of you who are joining with us via the live stream. It's so good to have you with us here in the sanctuary. This morning, we've been drawn together for worship, and you have already done that as you have sung, well done. And this morning, we also come for fellowship. And so I invite you at this time to extend the peace of Christ and welcome one another or wave to those online at this moment. Let us do that. Amen. Well, you guys are extra awake because you got an extra hour of sleep. Yeah. I realize time change is great for those of us who are morning people like myself, but it's horrible for those of you who are like staying up late at night and it's dark and you're kind of grouchy as soon as 5 p.m. rolls around. So hang in there. Spring will come. Thanks, Steve says. Thanks. I love the season of fall. It's just such a wonderful time. This morning, the flowers are given by Sue Siebold in honor of her special friend, Gail Pickert. And he is with the Saints in Glory. And so thank you for these beautiful flowers this morning, Sue. Well, let us now send our hearts in worship. Let us pray. God, you are our deliverer. So draw us now into worship. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear you, our minds to comprehend, and our spirits to encounter the revelation that you have for us this day. Transform us with the truth of your love and grace. This we ask in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let's join together in a responsive call to worship inspired by Psalm 91. Let all who live by faith in God the Almighty proclaim, Lord, you are my refuge and my fortress. My God, I will trust forever. Let all who trust in the Lord know that holy love surrounds us. God's protection will follow us throughout our days. When we call out to the Lord, we know that we are heard. God is with us in every trial and temptation. The Lord lives. Let the God of our salvation be exalted. Praise the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Let's stand and sing those words together.
Now
Let us pray. Oh God, you speak your word, and it is life to our souls. As we have sung, Word of God, speak, you do. For you have said, look, behold, I am making all things new. Oh God, it is your chesed, It is your steadfast love that leads us to this moment of confession, to repentance, where we turn our face again towards you. Holy God, you are creator of the stars and the seas. Your steadfast love is shown in every living thing, and your word calls forth countless words and countless souls spring forth into life. It's your law that revives and refreshes our soul. Lord God, you brought us out of slavery into freedom in Christ. But we confess time and time again, we forsake the joy of our salvation for the things of this world. Lord, we have failed to walk in your ways. We have reimagined your commandments and precepts to suit our own preconceptions and interests rather than the ways and the values of the kingdom of God that we see in Jesus Christ. And so we ask this morning that you would renew us, that you would heal us, that you would restore a conviction within our very souls to walk in your way and to be Christ here, the very image of your goodness and love. And so hear us now as we come before you in this moment with our own personal confessions during this time of silence. Lord, as we have sung, you have called us to be still and know that you are God, that you are here in this place, for you are Emmanuel. And so we've lifted these prayers, both spoken and unspoken, in Jesus' name. Amen. Here are the good news, the assurance of pardon, the promise from Psalm 91. For God says, "Those who love me, I will deliver. I will protect those who know my name. When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them and show them my saving power." Sisters and brothers, let us trust the good news of the gospel that in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you, choir. It's beautiful. How good it is to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Our God who holds our past, present, and future in His hands. Our God who is our only hope, in whom we trust. How good it is to be in the house of the Lord. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. Let's pray. Gracious God, we pray that you would help us to love you more deeply, to walk with you more closely, and to trust you more fully by the power and the indwelling of your Holy Spirit. So be with us now this morning as we keep our eyes upon Christ, the author and the perfecter of our faith, in whose name we pray. Amen. Since the people of Israel left Egypt, they have had their fair share of challenges, wouldn't you say? There was the barrier crisis, the Red Sea, a water crisis, a food crisis, another water crisis, a full-scale war crisis, and a leadership crisis. Until finally, they reached the base of a mountain to set up camp and take a time for rest. This all took place within 3 months after having left behind their life of slavery in Egypt. Can you just imagine the mind, the body, the heart, the collective spirit of all of those people during those 3 challenging months, having left a life of slavery year after year after year in Egypt? And then they finally get to the base of this mountain. Oh, and by the way, I did say they reached the base of a mountain, didn't I? Mount Sinai is where they reached, which also happens to be called by another name, Mount Horeb. Now, wait a minute. Where have we heard of that name before? It was back in Exodus chapter 3 when an 80-year-old Moses, who had gone into exile into the wilderness 40 years before, this Moses who was just minding his own business, looking after the sheep of his father-in-law's flock, here he is on the outer banks of Midian, and then suddenly he has an encounter. It was there at Mount Horeb when God met with Moses. You remember now, don't you? God spoke to him from a burning bush, calling Moses to himself into a loving, faithful relationship. And God provided Moses with a responsibility of what? Leading God's people out of exile, out of this slavery situation in Egypt. And it's where God reminded Moses of his covenant for his treasured people, that what? That God will be their God. They will be blessed to be a blessing, to be mediators of God's grace to other nations. And then this led to the sending when God told Moses, I now want you to go back to Egypt to go before Pharaoh and call for God's people, let them go. And then God gave Moses this promise at the mount right before he left for Egypt. Listen closely. God said, I will be with you, and this shall be a sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. Moses had learned a number of things during this encounter, but one thing he has learned for sure, one thing that all of us have learned here of utmost importance, this God, our God, is a relationship God. God doesn't stand at a distance far away from his creation. This God desires, enjoys, and takes pleasure in relationships, loving, growing, thriving, conversational, fulfilling relationships. This God is engaged with his creation. This God is engaged with his people that he has created. Now, how do we know this, church? Well, we know this because God has pursued us. You are sitting here right now. God has revealed his sacred name. He's given us of his word. I will read it in a moment, don't worry. He has expressed his love. He's extended grace through Jesus. And this God has made promise after promise to us. Promises that he has been and he will be faithful to. It doesn't get any better than that, right, folks? So Moses heard this promise that one day he would return to this mountain to worship God with the people of God, and this promise has been driving every part of Moses' being to get through crisis after crisis after crisis, to get the people of God to the base of the mountain so that they may what? So that they may worship God. And here they are. They made it. Time to take a victory lap, but not for long. They're at the base of Mount Sinai, Mount Horeb, back where it all started for Moses. It's where the relationship began, where the promise of worship would be fulfilled. It's there where God is going to answer the question now for them, the question we should be on the edge of our seats for, as they were, how shall we now live? Now that we have entered into a relationship with you, God, how do we live as the people of God? Not only in wilderness times, not only in the promised land times, but those times are sweet, but also in every time in between. This is a good question, isn't it? For every relationship that desires to be healthy, this is a good question. Defining the expectation of how one shall now live in a new and ongoing relationship. I still remember vividly Jennifer and I on our wedding day. The vows were spoken, and then the pastor, during his sermon, placed before us our newfound responsibilities for this relationship so that it would not only sustain day to day, year to year, but that it would thrive as a relationship. And he preached from Philippians chapter 2, verse 3 and 4. Listen to this. Do nothing from selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. And as he looked at the two of us, he said, and also to the interest of the other person. Now we have taken these words to heart. We're not perfect. We've fallen short, but we've taken them to heart. Why? Because we desire to have a healthy and growing relationship. And I think how much more important is our relationship with God? More important than any earthly relationship that we might have. It's more loving, intimate, and life-giving. And maybe that's why God at times likens our relationship with him as a relationship to a parent. But there are many places in Scripture where God likens our relationship with him as one of a marriage. And he places before us an expectation in this relationship of how we now shall live. not as mere do's and don'ts. Because I think if you look at a relationship with do's and don'ts, it's not going to go well. But God wants us to see these as life-giving movements, responsibilities in a mutually loving relationship. So could we liken this story, the point in the story I'm going to read to you soon, to the people of God entering into a marriage-type relationship with God? And I believe so. Now, before they enter into God's presence, before they have this first worship service at the base of Mount Horeb, before they make their vows with God, there is preparation that needs to take place. In chapter 19, God calls for Moses to ascend up the mountain. This will happen three times in chapter 19. In other words, God has something to say to Moses. You might call it a call to worship. God begins by reminding Moses of what he has done. I have been faithful to my promise to you. I have delivered you from Egypt. And I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do, Moses. I'm going to carry you all the way to the promised land. And God reminds Moses that the people of God, get this, will become his treasured possession as they trust in him. There's this passage in chapter 19 when God speaks of himself as the mother eagle, carrying them like chicks on his wings, nurturing them that one day they will take flight. In other words, God is saying, in this relationship, I am yours, and you are mine. And then God reminds Moses that he will now renew his covenant with the people of God, these vows, placing before them the commands in life if they want to have a life well lived. And then God tells Moses, now's the time. Prepare the people for worship, for they will soon hear my voice, and I will dwell in their midst. So on the third day, since they arrived at this mount, the moment has come just as promised, and God shows up. Listen to this from chapter 19. There was thunder and lightning, as well as a thick cloud on the mountain, and a blast of a trumpet so loud that all the people who were in the camp trembled. Mount Sinai was wrapped in smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire. The smoke went up like the smoke of a kiln, where the whole mountain shook violently as the blast of the trumpet grew louder and louder and louder. Moses would speak, and God would answer him in thunder. And when the Lord descended upon Mount Sinai to the top of the mountain, the Lord summoned Moses to the top of the mountain once more, and Moses went up. And then Moses went back down to the people to prepare them to hear the voice of God. And then God spoke all these words before Moses for the people to hear. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I am the Lord your God. I am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love, hesed, mercy, grace to a thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your town. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it, set it apart. Honor your father and mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or male or female slave or ox or donkey or anything that belongs to your neighbor. When all the people witnessed the thunder and lightning, the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, they were afraid and trembled and stood at a distance. And they said to Moses, "You speak to us and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid, for God has come only to test you and to put the fear of him upon you so that you do not sin." And then the people stood at a distance while Moses drew near to the thick darkness where God was. Now you know the context. The people of God have heard the voice of their Lord. They've heard it for themselves. Several weeks ago, I visited one of our church members at Hoag Hospital. The way that her bed was situated in the room, she couldn't see out the sole window over here. And so I walked over to the window, and I turned to her and I said, "Wow, what of you?" And she said, "Steve, I can't see it. Describe it to me." And so I described the lovely homes down below, the palm trees swaying in the wind, the beautiful coastline, the blue ocean, the white caps, the drifting clouds, and the brilliant sun. And as I was sharing, I stopped for a minute, and I went, wait a minute. And I took out my phone, and I took a picture of the view. And then I walked over to her bed, and I sat next to her, and I showed her the picture. Her eyes lit up. Big smile on her face. What a difference to see it for herself. And I say, what a difference for the people of Israel to hear the voice of God for themselves. How important to hear the voice of God and understand that it was given in the context of worship. Given in context of giving these people what they needed for life together. It's encompassed in a loving and caring relationship with God who wants what's best for them. Now let's remember, these were given to a people who were already delivered. They were already loved, God's treasured possession. These commands were not given so that they might earn favor with God. Never approach the commandments like that. They already had God's mercy. It was there in verse 6. And these commands weren't given to keep the people in a right relationship with God. They already had that by God's grace. These commands were given to live by faith, to have a vibrant, growing, healthy, and God-centered life. And notice it all begins with those first four commands. God calling himself our Lord, our God in relationship. God putting before us what worship is to look like, that we are to give him our faith and our loyalty. God provides his name, his precious, intimate name. We can know him by name. And then God calls for us to cease in our work. Cease in your busyness. I want to spend time with you. The Lord of the universe wants to spend time with us. And then it leads to honoring and respecting parents and elders. Parents taking their role with utmost sincerity. And then calling everyone to value life, fidelity, ownership, truth-telling, and creating healthy boundaries. This is what it means to love God and to love our neighbor. And we hear in these commands, to a people who have just left the chaos of Egypt, who have gone through crisis after crisis, we hear in this a Genesis sequel. They're being recreated with the voice of God. Do you see it now? The God who created them to be the people that he wants them to be in a loving relationship with him and with others. when the religious leaders of Jesus' time asked him what the greatest commandment is. Jesus summarized all 10 commandments by saying, "You are to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your strength, all of your mind, and you are to love your neighbor as yourself." This Jesus, who lived a perfect and sinless life, fulfilling all of God's commands on our behalf to become our mediator, our go-between, the greater Moses, to be our mercy and strength, our hesed. He is in the center of the law in verse 6. And we receive this through his death and his resurrection by faith. It's this Jesus who reaches out to us, calling us to follow him by faith as we live into God's covenant love together, to live life as it was meant to be. How intent is this God to be in a relationship with us, to send his son Jesus, to fulfill the law on our behalf, to indwell us with the Holy Spirit, to live into this covenant of faith together, and to forgive us over and over and reconcile us together. So may we say of God, may we sing of our God, "There is no one like you. There is none beside you." Lord, there is no one like you, and there is none beside you. You are the one who has made a covenant with us, a covenant of faith and love, indwelling us with your Spirit, bringing grace and mercy that we may follow Jesus together as the people of God. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward as we give generously to the mission and ministry of Laguna Presbyterian Church.
The lyrics to this song are printed in your bulletin. If you'd like to join us on the chorus and the bridge.
Song we could ever sing, worthy.
Let us stand together and give thanks.
Let us pray. Oh God, you are worthy of every song we could ever sing, and you call us to love you, oh God, with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and then to love our neighbor as self. And may these gifts this morning be a visible sign of that growing love for you and our love for the world. Bless this offering for the work of your kingdom through your church gathered here in this sanctuary and online with brothers and sisters around the world. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. And so let us bring the prayers of the people. Let us pray. God who redeems us, God who resurrects us, God who recreates us, God who brings life. Tune our ears to voices long silence and open our hearts to each other, and particularly to those who suffer. For those who are facing times of trial, sadness, grief, and change. Help us to marvel at the many extraordinary ways you are present to us in this world. God of grace, we offer our prayers for the needs of others and commit ourselves to serve as we have been served in Jesus Christ. God of time eternal in this moment in the life of our nation, we pray for wisdom and discernment. We pray for humility, that we might extend your grace where differences or indifference threaten to divide us, and that we might have the courage to seek the unity in your command to love as you love. Guide us as we elect new leaders to govern and to guide. You, O God, are above all. You, O God, hold the nations in your hands. And your love for the world is displayed before us this morning if we but look to the cross of Christ. Break into our lives, O God, to reveal your eternal wisdom, that we might walk your paths of righteousness. Call us to journey together as your church here in Laguna Beach in common purpose and common mission, welcoming everyone to live into your story, O God, of hope and love. A community of blessedness that beckons our neighbors with the joy we have in Christ. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, let me draw your attention to a few announcements in our Sunday connections. You'll notice a few things that are happening this morning, of course. Coffee and Deacon Donuts and fellowship on the patio right out here in the courtyard. Our children's choir is rehearsing at 10, and I believe Crystal is already headed over that way. They will go till 10:45. Our student ministry happens during the 10:30 service. Our youth, our middle school and high school, meet down with Stephen. He's doing this over here. You can't see him. Stephen down in the youth center. They have a great time of fellowship and what all do you guys do? Just conversations, small groups, all kinds of stuff. They have a great time together. What's that?
I like it to be a mystery.
A mystery. He likes it to be a mystery. We keep it a mystery. There is a new member class at 10:30 this morning over in the forest room, which is right through the Rose Garden. Thank you, Kathy, for leading that for us. And if you want to just learn more about Laguna Press, you're welcome to go to that class and learn about church history. It's really quite enlightening. You get like the Reader's Digest version, which is really wonderful, though. This morning, I encourage you to sign up for two things that are happening out on the courtyard. The first is, yes, it is that time again. It is almost hospitality night, about a month and 3 days from today. What? How can that be? So I am encouraging you to sign up to bake homemade Christmas cookies. Grab your grandmother's recipe or your great aunt's recipe and bake up those cookies. It is time, calling all bakers, on your mark, get set, bake! Yes, if you're watching the Great British Baking Show, it has started again as well. So may that encourage you to bake something special. There's a cart out there on the patio, and you can, if nobody's there, just sign up. There's a little clipboard. Sign your name, and tells you how many cookies you can see right there. And there's a little demonstration there. Those look really cute, making me hungry. And give us your email address in case we need to remind you. Also, Kathy Sizer is going to be out there in the church patio for ladies' lunch. That is happening on November 17th. So ladies, if you've lost a significant other, we invite you to this lunch. It's going to be over in the forest room. Is that right? So they're going to do that again over here. And so sign up for that. It's going to be 12 o'clock on November 17th. But sign up today. Let's see. Hang on. Don't go anywhere, folks. Almost done. I promise. I got a lot of stuff up here. There's a lot going on. Okay. Book talk. Book talk is happening November 12th. You have a few more days to read this book. Get it on audio and just really fast, close to death. Enjoy that. There is a congregational meeting on November 17th, and that meeting is for the approve the slate of elders, deacons, and I don't think we have any Carson Trust, but Laura's going to talk about that in a minute for 2025. Last but not least, see this little card. Ken Cornelison is going to put these in your hands as you exit the sanctuary, and this is to support Meals for Military Families over the holidays. And you read about that in connection, so take one of these cards with you to bring back a cash or check next Sunday, the 10th or the 17th. How did I do, Ken? Is that good? You say, oh, I got a thumbs up from Ken. I think that's it. I would like to introduce Laura Nagel, who is the chairperson and part of the trustees of the Carson Trust Foundation. Laura.
Hi, good morning. I am excited to be here today to share about Carson Trust. A lot of you may not know about it. It has been around for almost 70 years, and it has provided funding for over 35 seminary students to go to seminary for their ministerial education. It has been an amazing trust for us. And we have been in the enviable position, those of us who've served on it, where our job is to give money to people, to deserving people, to pursue education. We are also in the enviable position that the base principle for this trust is being extremely well managed and continues to grow faster than we can spend it. It is a wonderful problem to have. So the trustees that have, in the past year or two, have decided that we would take a look at it and see if we could expand it beyond the seminary education we had done it for. So we went and we looked back at the original trust and will, consulted with an attorney on the trustee, you know, talked about it, and the original thing talked about ministerial education. And then we thought, ministerial education, aren't we supposed to equip all the saints for ministry? Isn't that what it says? And isn't there's another part of the Bible that talks about not putting your talent under a rock, you know, and there's this resource that we have. So we, over the past year, the current Carson trustees, who I do want to list their names because we worked really hard on this, myself, Ken Cornelison, Bill Rookledge, Cheryl Behan, Marianne Thomas, Ben Chung, with, of course, significant input from Marv Drew and Steve Sweet, we revised the bylaws, looking at that ministerial education and saying that ministerial education includes seminary and lifelong learning that equips the saints to better carry out our church mission and spread the gospel to our immediate community and beyond. So in light of that, we've revised the bylaws. They've been signed off decently and in order as good Presbyterians. And we are opening it up to other types of educational opportunities that help move the church forward in their mission. For example, someone wants to become a Bible study leader, and there's a class for that. We would love you to apply to the Carson Trust, and we'd love to support you in that endeavor. If our bookkeeper wanted to go to a finance class on how to do bookkeeping for churches, we think that supports the ministry. Money's important. Managing it well, even more so. We would support that. So we've opened it up, and we created a form, because we have to have a form that you can fill out saying, you know, what you're interested in doing and why and how that will support the church. And then the trustees will look at it, we can approve it, and then we'd like to support that for you. So if you have questions or ideas or are thinking of doing something like that yourself, we'll have a card out on the patio with people from the trust on there to answer any of your questions. So remember, we're now looking to equip all the saints, because it's not just the ministers that do the ministry of the church. It's all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. Next Sunday is Stewardship Sunday, and I hope you'll join me with me in bringing your commitment card, sharing what you're going to provide and give to the church for 2025. It's your commitment card that helps our session plan for the next year. It's your generous giving that supports our worship, our staff, our children, preschool, youth, and adult ministries, our local mission and foreign missionaries and foreign mission, and I could go on, and of course, caring for this beautiful campus. So I hope you'll bring your commitment card next Sunday. I also hope you'll join me this week in praying for our nation, praying for our church, and for ourselves as disciples of Christ, that we would reflect the love and the grace of Jesus in all that we say and all that we do. Amen. Amen. Let us stand now for the blessing. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge God, and God will make your paths straight. God bless you this week. Amen. You may be seated for the postlude. Amen.